Dear Tulip, you will be glad to know that now I have a technical book titled Articles on Ductile Iron Pipelines and Framework Agreement Methodology, which covers 9 of my technical papers published in peer-reviewed national and international journals. This book has been published by Scholars Press, Latvia, European Union. The book attempts to elaborate the use of ductile iron pipelines in irrigation application, gravity sewer application, wet slurry application, restrained joint application, and use in steep incline and hilly terrain, life cycle cost analysis between various kinds of pipe materials, feasibility of recycled wastewater for irrigation, a deliberation on framework agreement procurement methodology, and emerging challenges in pipe distribution network based irrigation projects. Sorry for boring you with unnecessary facts. You may also be aware that I am working on my 6th literary project and have been recently invited to the Kolkata Literary Meet to discuss about Dark Side of the Mind, where I also plan to take up issues related to postmodern anxieties. On the day I have been invited to speak in a panel discussion, there are many other wonderful sessions with celebrated authors, which I would like to attend as a delegate. I also hope to meet a few interesting people during the course of the day. There is a festival dinner invitation at the end of the day at Taj Bengal, which I intend to attend briefly and thereafter meet you at the park for some desserts and coffee. I must tell you something interesting. The other day, I happened to glance upon your father, who seems to have stuck on to his athleticism even at this age. 12 years back, he was a great athlete, and I was a short, pot-bellied senior engineering professional and an author. Why is it that your mother chose me all of a sudden and decided to abandon an athlete is a deep mystery to me. Well, I still remain short and pot-bellied, and I'm addicted to my engineering profession and my profession as an author. Over the years, I have seen you growing up as a wonderful woman, good-looking, kind and sharp, witty individual. I'm your stepfather, which means I'm not your father, but at some level I do think I'm your father, because I would like to believe your creative self would not have bloomed the way it has had I not been overseeing your growing up years. Now that you are a grown-up woman and a creative woman, I seek validation of my art from you. You know that all my life I have been overpowered by the idea of duality. To make my point explicable, I write down a poem for you to enjoy. I broke Sandy's arms. I broke Sandy's spinal cord. I broke Sandy's legs. I hammered Sandy's Adam's apple with a spanner. I put a rusted rod through his spleen and lungs. With a stick, I fractured his pelvic girdle. He stopped breathing, tired and broken, and splintered into smithereens, viscous in a fountain-like pool of blood, sweat, saliva, and body juices. My hate, fuming like a raging furnace, unceasing molten metal. I thought death will square my anger. It did not. I wanted Sandy to get up and resist me deliriously so that I could punch, paw, bite, and tear flesh from his bones, mix his blood with gasoline, and throw at him back with a burning matchstick. He would burn, but not turn to ashes. Burn forever
to resonate my hate, what Sandy could do, I never could. Sandy laughed freely while I got depressed with each passing day. The plasma within oscillating in frenzy in unknown agony. Sandy explored the marine world, starfishes, octopuses, jellyfishes, eels, seahorses, corals and goldfishes, while I wanted to stick to my dungeon. Sandy made love while I wanted to violate woman. Sandy wanted to reform. He always spoke of integrity and ethics. I loved cutting deals by hook or crook. I looked at anybody as competition and abhorred it. Yet, we returned to each other in one body. Sandy, an angel, and I, an untamed beast. I know you are at the cusp of venturing into marine conservation. We will discuss duality, my ideas around duality and marine conservation when we meet for our desserts and coffee session at the park on January 22. Love, Baba Zula.
Baba Zula overheard the opening idea at the inaugural session of the literary meet. In life, there are certain things that are within our control, and a lot many things that are beyond our control. The aggregate of determinate and indeterminate factors makes life indeterminate. Uncertainty is closely associated with indeterminateness, as indeterminate problems are likely to have multiple solutions. Baba Zula has been vociferous about Anna Karenina by Leo Tolstoy for a long time. Anna Karenina was a doting wife and a mother. Later, she abandoned her family and home in pursuit of passionate love for another man. The union with her lover did not pacify her soul. She remained restless and desirous of more and more love, and in painful agony for a son whom she left. And she was quite surprised by the fact that her insurmountable love for her lover did not stop her from casting an influence or charm on other men. Her anxieties led her to inflicting death upon herself. At no point in time, to the entire very fat novel, we are in a position to predict what Anna would do next. It is as if within the Anna that we can see, there are multiple Annas that are driving her in self-contradictory directions. When Anna Karenina was written, the influence of genes on man's actions was not well understood. The authors of that time, and until much later, would meticulously detail the physical circumstances around a character so that the readers could understand why somebody behaved the way she did. Yet, the readers in the greatest of texts found something amiss. With greater understanding of genetics, authors understood that along with immediate physical context, family behavior and lineage are of great significance. Their texts soon got modified. Baba Zula has been vociferous about Nikhilesh's economic views in Ghore Baire by Robi Thakur for a very long time. In Ghore Baire, Nikhilesh walks two self-contradictory paths. He sincerely wants his wife to embrace Western thought and education. On economy, he prefers imported goods to goods manufactured in India on cost-effective grounds. Those would be financially viable for peasants working on his farms and estates. In the first instance, he exhibits the demeanor of a benevolent elite exposed to English education and ways. Whereas, in the second instance, he is clearly opposed to national entrepreneurs, exposing his feudal roots. Nikhilesh does not evolve to become a national entrepreneur on the strength of financial surplus capital amassed through farm produce tax, but in the world of ideas, makes a quantum jump to internationalism only on the strength of his education, which can at best be fragile. Babazula's moot point about duality is, when light was first considered to be wave particle, gravity a field and not force, and it was mathematically established, what is the quantum of uncertainty in defining a particle's location and or momentum for the collision between the observatory field and the particle's own field creates such uncertainty at the roots. Classical physics and how we would think in the years to come would change forever. This impacted social theory, literature and arts, and artistic and aesthetics theory. Fundamental to everything was the recognition of duality, which many years back was postulated by Hegel in his master-slave theory. We could be slaves, masters, slave masters, and master-slaves in varying orders. This is better understood with the postmodern development of psychiatry. Babazula attended a session on schizophrenia at the literary meet and got a copy of the presentation made there and read out to Tulip. Oliver John Mason of Research Department of Clinical Educational and Health Psychology, University College London, London, United Kingdom, concludes in his opinion, article dated September 14, 2014, titled "The Duality of Schizotypy. Is it both dimensional and categorical?" as follows. Overall, I have attempted to argue that even in the non-pathological domain of schizotypal individual differences, there are numerous possibilities for both dimensional and categorical expressions, both of traits and states. Taxonomic, which means concerned with the classification of things, expression has greater support for negative schizotypal features such as anhedonia, which means the inability to feel pleasure, and potentially some associated neurocognitive features. Positive schizotypy, on the other hand, sees much empirical support for true dimensionality at both genotype, which means the genetic constitution of an individual organism, and phenotypic, which means relating to the observable characteristics of an individual resulting from the interaction of its genotype with the environment expression. Even here, however, there is room for gene-environment interactions and epigenetics, which means the study of changes in organisms caused by modification of gene expression rather than alteration of the genetic code itself, to produce discontinuous results. As a rider to this final point, it is apposite, which means apt in the circumstances, to point out that there may equally be important phenotypic consequences for schizotypy in the absence of a pathogenic environment or the presence of a protective factor such as high cognitive or emotional intelligence. Thus, positive schizotypy is also associated with a range of healthy or at least adaptive outcomes. Again, paralleling the advantages seen with cluster analytic approaches, Tabak and Weissman Damamani identified several schizotypal latent profiles. The negative, disorganized, schizotypy profile had the poorest levels of well-being and schizotypes, which means one who suffers from a mental disorder characterized by severe social anxiety, thought disorder, paranoid ideation, derealization, transient psychosis, and often unconventional beliefs. Solely with positive features had the highest commensurate with non-schizotypes. Taking a similar latent profile, analytic approach to a non-clinical sample, Horry et al. Described 15% as high positive schizotypy adaptive and possessing of high self-directedness, cooperativeness, and self-transcendence. This is consistent with growing evidence of the highly creative and spiritual outcomes for some schizotypal individuals and may point to the operation of antagonistic pleiotropy, which means occurs when one gene influences two or more seemingly unrelated phenotypic traits or genetic linkage such that schizotypal traits survived throughout our evolutionary history. Myth: schizophrenia means you have a split personality. Reality: this is a classic myth. A split personality, also called a dissociative identity disorder or a multiple personality disorder, is extraordinarily rare and debatable. It is quite distinct from schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is a thought disorder. The myth likely stems from the fact that in schizophrenia, there is a breakdown or split between thoughts, emotions, and behavior. This split results in the person confusing reality and fantasy. The person may experience delusions and hallucinations, and emotions may become blunted or inappropriate. When most people think of schizophrenia, they think of someone who is seeing things and hearing voices. These are what are called positive symptoms. But people with schizophrenia have negative symptoms too. Among the common negative symptoms are low motivation, difficulty forming social connections, and a flat, blunted affect. A lack of pleasure in everyday activities, rarely speaking, and difficulty paying attention are also symptoms, according to the American Psychological Association. Babazula was confronted by a Marxist at the literary meet where Babazula made his points on Marxian thought, referring to chapter 63 of his Random Subterranean Mosaic 2012-2018. Karl Marx's two greatest contributions in political economy are as follows. 1. Alienation theory postulated in the economic and philosophic manuscripts of 1844. 2. Surplus theory, MCMC, postulated in Das Kapital, 1867. He concluded that capitalism would crumble because of its inherent conflicts and lead to a revolution by the proletariat, taking over means of production by who produce, participate by giving their labor, and not the class that invests capital in enterprises, which would lead to inequities being reversed. However, Marx failed to establish 1. The roadmap of such a revolution leading to the capture of economic power, the nature of the entity that would represent the common interests of the proletariat. Later, Lenin theorized that it would be the Communist Party. 2. The concrete nature and dynamics of a post-revolution society. 3. How industrial society would proceed towards destruction of the ecology comprehensively. 4. Reduction of a human being's identity to political economics, which gravely negated all other pluralities. 5. How history was a history of class struggles. It was only assumed to be a fact in the Communist Manifesto. History was not studied empirically to demonstrate this alleged fact. 6. Whether the proletariat would retain its revolutionary capacity as means of production and living conditions better pursuant to economic movements, militant or otherwise. 7. The relationship between the development of human brain and prolonged malnourishment due to years and years and years of impoverishment. The proletariat of the capitalist society were mostly the progeny of landless peasants of a feudal society. Could thought leaders have emerged out of this class, having undergone the duress of relentless economic inequity, because of which their brains could not have been fully developed due to historical hunger? We also have to appreciate that Karl Marx existed in a time which was defined by Newtonian physics and Euclidean geometry, and his study was mostly limited to the British, French, German, and later the North American economies. 20th century brought with its mass production, quantum physics, tensor calculus, computers, artificial intelligence, advanced genetic engineering, advanced anthropological studies, which collectively turned upside down many, many assumptions and wisdom of the earlier centuries. Socio-politically speaking, 20th century brought forward practice of democracies, a system of forcing political equality upon economic inequality, and this forced political equality fails to alleviate the inbuilt economic inequality. Imperialism, neocolonialism, consumerism, hyper-consumerism, identity wars, terrorism, climate change, advent of neo-capitalism, disproportionate growth of economy among nation-states following different economic models. Plekhanov brought Marxism to Tsarist Russia, which was primarily feudal and laced with inhuman oppression, and Lenin revolutionized it theoretically and practically, resulting in the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917. It failed gradually over the years. I summarize the following reasons, principally based on my study of the Bolshevik experiment. 1. It is not the proletariat who captured power of the state. It was the Communist Party, assumed to approximate the proletariat, a party that comprised valorous intellectual elite, political and military strategists. The political power was ferociously centralized. Capitalists were replaced by political bureaucrats and technocrats. 2. Industry was given the primary focus to economic growth, thereby competing with the Western world, instead of finding a unique way to exist more harmoniously, ecologically, and in a decentralized manner. 3. The citadel of arts, culture, and free independent thinking were overturned, crushing everything that keeps a civilization alive. Incompleteness of the Marxist thought or the failure of the Bolshevik experiment do not prove Marx wrong. To my mind, Marxian thought is a scientific, socio-economic political theory rooted in political economy of its time and based on revolutionary imagination and intuition. Like Einstein's general theory of relativity, Einstein's intuitions are being proven till this day, which means the scientific framework postulated by Einstein is getting further expanded and validated with time. What happened with Marx was, because of his theory's altruistic aims, revolutionaries wanted to adopt his theory to validate their ideas of a social and political revolution. Before his theory, including its incompleteness, growing with time was studied, made relatively more complete by integrating it with emerging realities, theories, and made into a more forceful, ever-emerging and visionary economic and political idea. People like Trotsky tried but faced death at the hands of Stalin. There have been many other Trotskys and many other Stalins in history, sadly. Tulip made her points on marine conservation to Babazula. We know two very distressing things about the Earth's biological diversity. One is that it is being destroyed very rapidly. In the next half century, less than one human lifetime, the Earth could lose blue whales, giant pandas, tigers, black rhinoceroses, and millions of lesser-known species. Entire ecosystem types, such as tropical dry forests, mangroves, and floodplain rivers, could be damaged beyond repair. Our planet is now facing the most devastating biological catastrophe in the last 65 million years. Since a huge asteroid hit the Earth and caused appalling damage, killing off the dinosaurs and more than half of the planet's other species. But today's mass extinction has a very different cause: the way we humans live our lives. Since the early 1980s, increasing attention has been paid to the importance of biodiversity and to the increasing number of species being depleted at an alarming rate. Many biologists believe that we are in the midst of a mass extinction because the rate of species loss is higher now than ever before. It is estimated that between 17,000 and 100,000 species are eliminated each year. Studies have shown that as many as 1 in 8 plant species are threatened with extinction. The majority of these species losses are due to human activity, particularly habitat destruction as more and more land becomes developed for human use. The global destruction of rainforests, coral reefs, mangroves, and other rich habitats has become a hot issue being addressed by conservation organizations and by global legislation to try and reverse damaging trends and encourage sustainable management of resources. Some of the basic threats to biodiversity include increasing human populations out of balance with the scale of natural resources, heavy consumption and excessive exploitation of natural resources, lack of sufficient knowledge and understanding of species and ecosystems, destruction of ecosystems and habitats due to increased land use, urbanization and pollution, underestimating the value of nature and its resources, global climate change, ecological disasters such as large-scale fires and floods. New global agreements, such as the Convention on Biological Diversity mentioned above, are helping nations recognize the existing value of their natural resources and its value to future generations. The convention was developed during the 1992 Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro where world leaders agreed on a comprehensive strategy for sustainable development that meets our needs while ensuring that the Earth's resources will be sustained for future generations. This agreement established good stewardship of these resources as nations continue to build economic development. The three main goals of the convention are conservation of biological diversity, sustainable use of its components, fair and equitable sharing of the benefits from the use of genetic resources. The agreement commits countries to conserving biodiversity, developing tools for sustainability, and sharing the benefits.
From computers to internet, to robotics, to artificial applied intelligence, to machine learning, and very penetrative understanding of genes and gene modification and anthropology, we have traversed to an era of Internet of Things and services, where smart technology can provide enormous free time to people in an intensely inequitable and polarized world, where man is herself swinging within like a pendulum, a way nature has created her, with climate change threatening to erode the planet within a few years. With vast learning at man's disposal, the burning question is how it would use its resources to revert the process of extinction of human civilization. In spite of mammoth inventions and discoveries of mankind, we have not been able to fully grasp the duality of love and lust in human relationships. In the Museum of Innocence, Pamuk establishes a tale of pure love between Kemal Bey and Fuzun, his cousin. In The Unbearable Lightness of Being, Kundera establishes a lustful yearn between Thomas and Sabina. All of us are swinging between the extremes of this pendulum. At any given point in time, where we exist and how we exist is very complex to figure out.
Tulip discussed the hidden love story of T.S. Eliot. Let us look at a real-life example of unrequited love. A collection of more than 1,000 letters from the Nobel laureate T.S. Eliot to his confidant and muse, Emily Hale, was unveiled in the first week of 2020 after having been kept in sealed boxes at a U.S. university library for 60 years. The cachet promises to offer an intimate insight into the poet's life and work, and on the extent of his relationship with Hale, a source of speculation for decades. The 1,131 letters, which date from between 1930 and 1956, were donated by Hale to Princeton University Library more than 60 years ago, with a stipulation they remain sealed until 50 years after either Eliot's death or her own, whichever occurred last. He died in 1965 and she in 1969. The two had met in Cambridge, Massachusetts in 1912 when Eliot attended Harvard. They rekindled their friendship in 1927, by which time Eliot had moved to England. He corresponded frequently with Hale, who was from Boston and who taught drama at US universities, including Scripps College in California. Eliot ordered Hale's letters to him to be burned, according to biographers. I think it's perhaps the literary event of the decade. Anthony Kuder, an Eliot scholar and director of the T.S. Eliot International Summer School, told the Associated Press, I don't know of anything more awaited or significant. It's momentous to have these letters coming out. Their relationship must have been incredibly important, and their correspondence must have been remarkably intimate for him to be so concerned about the publication. He added, Eliot was born in St. Louis, Missouri in 1888. His best known works include The Wasteland, The Hollow Men, and Four Quartets. His letters to Hale began after the end of his first marriage to the Cambridge governess, Vivian Haywood. Scholars point to the first poem in the quartet series called Burnt Norton and named after a home in England Eliot visited with Hale as significant because of lines that suggest missed opportunities and what might have been. Eliot married his second wife, Valerie Fletcher, in 1957. The Eliot scholar, Francis Dickey, one of the editors on the complete prose of T.S. Eliot, said the poet was ashamed of his first marriage. The letters could reveal how close he and Hale were and if they ever considered marriage. She said, whatever else Hale was, she said, she was a link to the life he had left behind in the United States. The 12 boxes, which include photographs, ephemera, and clippings, were unsealed by Princeton University library staff in October 2019 to be scanned for digital viewing at the library from 2nd January. Susan Stewart, a professor of English at Princeton, who was present at the unsealing, said two senior librarians stood behind a table full of wooden crates, wielding dual pairs of tin snips. They proceeded in tandem to snap the copper bands holding the crates, and the wooden slats clattered to the table. She added that what little was known about the correspondence indicated Eliot wrote to Hale freely about his predilections, his fellow poets, and above all, his opinions as a reader. Daniel Link, the interim head of special collections at the library, said there was minimal, if any, reading during the unsealing. He expected that scholars from around the world would be traveling to Princeton in the first few days. It will be the special collections equivalent of a stampede at a rock concert, he told the Associated Press.
Another duality is the transition of a tyrant to a benevolent, or a benevolent to a tyrant. Such revolutionary transitions possibly happen because of traumatic circumstances. Real life stands testimony to this phenomenon. The duality of peace of solitude and craving for an audience is another duality that we go through. The other two often faced dualities are, how will we achieve true empathy? By intellectual understanding and realization or practice? It can be argued, it is a fine balance of both. In making an invention, how much of it is an intricate combination of imagination and intuition, or rigorous experimentation, collection and interpretation of results? Similarly, here it can be argued that it is a fine balance of both. Can we conclude that everything is in a state of constant transition, and it is change which is constant? In this river of life, how will mankind realize transitional duality and not constancy, and its infinite, small place in the universal space to usher into an era of controlled greed and hunger for power to revert the damages already inflicted upon the planet?